Hey everybody, welcome to BK Live. Thanks so much for joining us on this Wednesday. We're almost there. We've got a great show to ease you through the rest of the week. And we've come a long way in this country from the days when corporations felt free to dump chemical waste and God knows what else into waterways or the fields next to their factories. But decades, even generations of active polluting leave a lasting legacy. And here in Brooklyn, certainly we have not been spared. We have three Superfund sites. And today, Jared Murphy of City Limits gets an update on their status with a scientist, an activist, and a community advocate. Then you don't find a lot of what we'd call feminism in fairy tales. Cinderella may be brave, but her goal is to land a husband. Or in the traditional portrayals of women in kids' history books. Well, one Brooklyn mother decided it was time to change her daughter's steady diet of fantasy from those pretty but passive female role models, and thus was born Powerful Princesses. That's coming up. And then on the subject of powerful women, Michael Bellamy will introduce us to several members of the New York Riveters, who play in the National Women's Hockey League. We've also got great seats for a match between longtime rivals Varian High and St. Edmund's Prep, the only two high schools in Brooklyn with hockey teams. Then finally, we've invited Stan Parham from Brooklyn Buzz to come on and give us his list of new and some old places to revisit, to eat, drink, hear music, and just enjoy. We'll get all that started in a moment when Jared Murphy takes us on a tour of some of the borough's less scenic spots. Stay with us.
Salam is a doctrine, a cornerstone. Zabur was given to King David, followed by his son King Solomon. He understood the language of the birds, the ants and the genies, protected by the Almighty God, Lord of the worlds and heavens. David played and he pleased the Lord. The iron words made soft.
With its hip neighborhoods and soaring high-rises, there are dwindling signs in today's Brooklyn of the borough's past as a center of heavy industry. But the connections are there, the good ones, like budding new manufacturing and old factory buildings, and the bad, areas of the borough that have been polluted by long-gone companies and long-outdated infrastructure. In three areas of Brooklyn, along the Gowanus Canal, in Newtown Creek, and at the Wolf Alport site right on Bushwick's border with Queens, this tainted legacy is so extensive, the feds have declared them Superfund sites and begun a long process of research and remediation. Today, we're going to find out where that process stands and what impact it's having on neighborhoods. And so we're glad to be joined by Professor Joshua Cheng, Director of the Environmental Sciences Analytical Center at Brooklyn College. Hi, Professor.
Hi.
Michelle Delahouse, who is Executive Director of the Fifth Avenue Committee, has been monitoring the Gowanus Project. Welcome back to BK Live, Michelle.
Thank you.
And Willis Elkins, a member of the Newtown Creek Alliance. Thanks for joining us, Willis.
Thank you.
Professor Cheng, we should mention that we tried to find someone from the Wolf Alport site. That's a new site. It's in kind of a funky area. But The EPA recently put out a report talking about the radioactive activity at that site and said that, you know, putting shields in place and measures to reduce radon gas has reduced but not eliminated the health risk. So what is the purpose of Superfund? What are we trying to achieve, and how does the program work to try to get there?
Well, I think I can speak a little bit in general as to the Superfund program itself. This is a Superfund site is, in general, it's a contaminated site that is identified by EPA, and because this it poses the health risk to human or animals or the environment, and then it has to be placed on the national priority list. It's called NPL to be a Superfund site. So right now, in the United States, we have about 1,300 Superfund sites around the country. And if you look at the map of where these Superfund sites are, we have a very high density in the northeastern United States, especially New Jersey and New York. So that's about, you know, so Superfund, the designation of Superfund site allows the EPA to step in to do a very thorough investigation and develop a plan for remediation and make sure that it's cleaned up before it's put back to use for construction for any other kind of land use.
And so, Willis, at Newtown Creek, what has that process looked like so far?
Well, we got our designation in 2010, and we're still in the remedial investigation phase, which means the contractors of the EPA have gone out and spent about 2 or 3 years collecting lots and lots of data about what the contamination is, where it's most concentrated, and then from that they'll be putting forth a plan of cleanup. But a lot of the pollution comes from the historic industrial uses, specifically petroleum and heavy metal production and stuff like that. So it's pretty severe, but a lot of it's also at the bottom of the creek in the sediment. So we're still, in the next few years, we'll be analyzing, looking at the data and working with EPA to come up with the solutions of how to clean it up.
And figuring out also who's supposed to pay for it, right? That's part of the process.
Yeah, so that's a big process, is that you identify what are called PRPs, potentially responsible parties. And for Newtown Creek, we have 6 of those. A lot of those are mega corporations, as well as the city of New York, because of their sewage system, which is dumped untreated sewage and runoff into the creek for well over 100 years.
And Michelle, I know City of New York is also one of the parties in the Gowanus area.
That's right.
When the EPA was talking about making that a Superfund site, the city under Mayor Bloomberg was resistant. They thought that would slow down their efforts to clean up that area. Is that a concern that you and others in the community had, and has that played out at all? Where does that stand?
Well, first off, the Gowanus Canal Superfund site is the first Superfund site in New York City, and it was also designated in 2010. And it's actually the most densely populated Superfund site in the country. And, you know, the reality is that the EPA has really established a very aggressive timeline to complete the cleanup of the Gowanus Canal. And right now we're in the remedial design phase. We've already had a record of decision, the phase that was mentioned earlier for Newtown Creek. We're basically one step beyond that for Gowanus Canal. And the hope is to be complete with the full remediation of the canal in 2021. So I think that a lot of the fears that some people had, and certainly that the prior administration had about slowing down a cleanup process, is not coming true for the Gowanus Canal, and is something that no community member wants. I mean, the reality is the community has been living with the vestiges of the industrial uses and the contamination for many, many decades, and we want to see it clean up as quickly as possible, but also as thoroughly as possible, with significant community input. And, you know, the Gowanus Canal Community Advisory Group, of which I'm a member, has over 50 members. It's the largest CAG in the country. And so, you know, getting everybody's buy-in is really a significant part of the process.
So far, I think that the preliminary plan or the plans as they stand call for moving something like 600,000 cubic yards of sediment, maybe a price tag of $500 million. Professor, for lay people, we talk about cleaning up a site that suggests, you know, wiping it off with a damp cloth. Right. I'm assuming that's something. So what is involved with the Superfund cleanup? Is it about removing bad stuff? Is it about purifying it? Or is it about just covering up and hope that it doesn't bother us anymore?
Well, briefly speaking, it can be everything. So, whatever it takes to remove all the contaminated media, or, you know, treat the media to make it, you know, to contaminant level down to the level that they consider no health risk. So these are they set the goals during the Superfund process, basically. So you clean it up and reach that goal, so you consider it done. So there's a lot of work needs to be done in there. For example, to investigate get a site, I mean, you have four different aspects of things to look into. One of those is to look at the site conditions, whether it's a river, it's a lake, or it's something, a geology kind of thing in there, and then look at the type of contaminants, level of contaminants, and the special distribution of contaminants. And then look at the cost, you know, treatability studies, figuring out whether they can do it, and how much does it cost, and how long does it take to treat it. And also, you know, comprehensively speaking, you have to look at the health risk, actual health risk to human and to the environment. So it's a very comprehensive thing. And there may be various technologies that has to be involved to get, you know, to clean up each of these media, basically, to contain the contamination and then minimize the health risk in the end.
And the health risk, we should talk about that, because I know at the Gowanus site, there was the question of when you take the bad stuff out of where it currently is, where do you process it? That was a whole sort of separate debate. What do we know about health risks now? What has been studied about, you know, the effect that these areas were having on their surrounding community as they
sure.
exist? What effect the cleanup might have? What the future might look like? What are the risks?
The risk, as it relates to the Gowanus Canal, really had to do with folks coming in contact with the sediment or the raw sewage in the Gowanus Canal. And, you know, the Gowanus Canal remains a navigable waterway to this day, but despite certain attempts, people don't swim in the Gowanus Canal. People should not eat fish from the Gowanus Canal. And there could be health risks associated with swimming or with eating fish from the Gowanus Canal. And really the cleanup plan, which for the Gowanus Canal involves dredging and capping and also stopping the source materials from going into the canal. And the primary source materials are really three former manufactured gas plant sites that are along the canal that have long been disbanded or no longer used, but there's like liquid petroleum, if you will. Liquid tar that is very, very deep in the ground that continues to leach into the canal, and raw sewage. Like Newtown Creek, there's also an issue with raw sewage in the Gowanus Canal. So that has to be contained in retention tanks in addition to the other pieces. So, you know, the reality is that the EPA has laid out a plan that would mitigate and clean up all of those things. And the upland portion on the Gowanus Canal is under the jurisdiction of the State Department of Environmental Conservation. The canal itself is under EPA jurisdiction. But there is really significant coordination that needs to go on between all levels of government in order to have this cleanup be fulfilled.
Willis, what's the goal in Newtown Creek? Is it to achieve a waterway that we can look at and it won't gross us out, or do we want to actually go into it?
I don't want to speak for everybody in the community. I think that's something we're working through now, is to find a consensus of a vision we can all agree on. But I think so far we really want to see something that is restored to conditions as close as we can to sort of pre-industrial levels in terms of contamination. So we want to make sure there's not a health risk for anybody who comes in contact with the water or with the sediment. But there's also a, you know, interest that the community's really been robbed of what was there before the Industrial Revolution. This was a vast salt marsh ecosystem, and a lot of people, the native tribes that lived nearby as well as people that settled there, subsisted off of some of those populations of fish and oysters and stuff like that. So to just clean up the contamination and move it out and not address the natural ramifications that have happened as well, so we want to see a restoration effort take play as well throughout parts of the creek.
And we should say that the Superfund process is one of only a few going on. There's also the long-term control plans around the city's CSOs.
Right.
There's, I know in an area adjacent to Newtown Creek, there's the oil spill remediation, which is, I guess, somewhat connected. So this
yes.
is not happening in a vacuum.
Well, it's like at Gowanus, you have all these upland sites of contamination. And with Newtown Creek, like Gowanus, like a lot of parts of New York and New Jersey, there's a lot of contamination in the ground, and it's very difficult to really properly assess how that contamination might be feeding into the waterways. So it presents a lot of tricky aspects. Also with the, as we mentioned, the sewage, that is technically something to be remediated under the Clean Water Act, which is a separate federal jurisdiction. However, there's a lot of overlap because with sewage, there might also be coming chemical contaminants as well. So there's a lot of different agencies, and it gets very complicated. And sometimes that can be really frustrating for community members, that we just want to see the place cleaned up. And if we say we want this cleaned up, and then an agency says, well, that's not our problem, go talk to these guys. And they say, well, that's not our problem, go talk to these guys. It can be kind of frustrating. So we want to see a real comprehensive coordination amongst the agencies and responsible parties.
One thing that's interesting about these sites, I guess less so maybe the Bushwick site, is that they're in areas that are kind of hot, right? These are some of the areas that are being displaced, gentrified, whatever the word you want to use. What impact do you think the Superfund project has had on that? Has it slowed it down? Has it exacerbated? Is there any connection between development patterns and what's going on in the waterway?
Well, I think there's a couple things. One is that, you know, as the population in the city of New York grows, land that previously developers didn't develop on because it was too complicated or too costly to develop on, that's the last frontier, basically. You know, brownfield sites, you know, sites adjacent to Superfund sites are really the last frontier. I think there was a concern when the designation was made in 2010, which was obviously during the recession, that the Superfund designation for the canal was going to have a cooling effect on the real estate development boom that was going on. And the reality is it's hard to tease out what part of that was the designation and what part of that was just the fact that we were having a great recession. Regardless, the Bloomberg administration at that time, they were planning to rezone the area around the Gowanus Canal, and they took the EPA's designation as a Superfund site to basically say, this is too complicated for us to do right now. There's no question that there's a lot of interest, obviously, to redevelop areas along the Gowanus Canal. And I think the fact that there has been an engaged group of stakeholders and, quite honestly, a subsequent bridging Gowanus process, which is a community planning process to vision for the Gowanus, means there's a lot more consensus about what the community wants to see out of any redevelopment in the Gowanus that had existed prior. So hopefully that means that whatever happens in the future will, no matter what, the cleanup is good for the community, you know, whether or not development happens. Obviously, one day development will happen.
Professor, a quick answer to a very complicated question. Mm-hmm. You've written about the broader issue of heavy metal contamination mm-hmm. in city soil. Right. So are Superfund sites sort of the only things for us to worry about, or are they just sort of the biggest icebergs in a sea of potential contamination in the city?
Well, I think that's a really good question, actually. For us, you know, people living in the city, we're unfortunate to be left with so much different contaminants and almost everywhere in people's backyards, the community gardens, and so forth. And people, you know, there are two sides of it. One is that you can't, you know, get too nervous or get too frustrated about it because that's the reality. The two is that you have to look at the actual health risk with different type of contaminations, different type of contaminants or different levels or different places. What you do with the soil, with the place is what determines what the health risks are. So to placing things on the national priority list really, you know, helps to deal with this like a centralized, you know, bigger problems, but sort of spread it out. And I think people just have to take a different approaches to be careful to minimize their own health risk. So, you know, it's, yeah, go ahead.
Final topic is money. One of the concerns with Superfund was that the national fund has been kind of tapped out. That was raised about all the New York City sites. Given where we are in the process of finding responsible parties, have we sort of put those fears aside, or is that still a concern? Will the money be there when we need it to pay for the cleanup?
For the Gowanus Canal, there are literally several dozen PRPs, with the biggest ones being National Grid. Because of the manufactured gas plant sites that were along the canal. And the city of New York is a pretty significant PRP as well.
And Greenwood? I mean, Newtown Creek?
And Newtown Creek. Well, we have much fewer. There's only six PRPs, but we're also dealing with some of the largest companies that have ever existed, like ExxonMobil. So on one hand, it seems like there might be a lot of money. On the other hand, we've seen from other sites that some entities will spend as much money to delay a cleanup and to minimize a cleanup. You know, instead of spending the money on the cleanup themselves. So I think part of the issue is how Superfund has been operated nationally, and that the Superfund itself has kind of lost its funds. And now we're in a situation where when you have a contaminated site, the federal government or the state government has to work with that party. And so there's less, the power situation has changed. It's more of a negotiation. And we're seeing this a lot on the Hudson River with GE right now, where a lot of people are saying the Hudson River is not completely clean. And GE sort of has more power than I think they should in negotiating, saying, no, we're fine, and it's, you know, to be determined what's going to happen there. But I think we need to re-examine how the Superfund works and go back to a model where there is a fund that can pay for these cleanups, and we're not, you know, sort of please, corporation, clean this up, do good. But there's more enforcement action happening.
Right. Well, hopefully we can use this show and City Limits to keep on folks, make sure that they send their checks to the right address. And thank you all for coming on to talk about this. It's a very important issue. But what's the polar opposite of a heavily polluted Superfund site? How about the pure and impressionable mind of a child? Up next, the story of how a group of young girls are getting the chance to expand their horizons, well beyond what society usually offers them as a role model.
Who is it?
The messenger came in with a letter. The Empress demands, here's the letter. The Empress demands that you and your daughter, the little Princess Sophie, come to faraway Russia, which we saw on the map, and see if little Sophie is an acceptable wife for Prince Peter.
Powerful princess empowers girls with real princesses from history, who I hope will be strong role models. And we use storytelling and crafts and games and dress up and science projects to learn about real princesses from history and how they rose to power.
It's a masterpiece.
After you, can it be my turn?
Wait, let me. No, I'm going to hold your feet.
Lydia lapped it up. Soon she had a sheet she had wrapped around and was marching around. Oh, Mark Antony, I could not send ships for your army. And I thought, this is fabulous. We've gone from cleaning the floor to negotiating world power.
And I said, oh, hairdresser, not today, because I'm going to take over this country today. I don't have time to fix my hair. So in we went to...
The girls I work with, they're definitely affected by society's messages.
Nice at first. Are we going to make the necklace this week?
Not necklace. So.
What are we going to make?
You'll see. But at the same time, they are a little free in their minds to be whoever they want to be. They love the hands-on things where they can mess around. And they just like coloring, too. They love gluing on glittery things. And then they're kind of getting their markers around the picture of the princess herself. Yep. And it helps them kind of go into the character.
And Bob Bay, the girl or the book?
She's a girl. She was a lady.
Bob Bay?
Thanks. Oh, I'm going to read these books. And
Bob
do you
Bay
know?
Was a girl?
Yes. The governess was a girl. And so I began to read the books that Babette left me.
Babette is a girl?
Yes. Babette is a girl. Girls need stories of how do you do it? How do you get from where I am to becoming this confident person who finds her voice and asserts herself? Because it should be easy at this point, and it's not always, as a lot of grown-up women have found.
We get to learn about new kinds of princesses that we don't know about. I like she is nice.
One of the challenges in translating these personalities to a young age is younger girls are not ready to hear about an ambiguous princess in the sense that she has to be all good. The girls like a story that she was so nice she wanted to help all the people. I also think she just wanted to be in charge.
Do you think the people are going to say okay?
Yeah!
Doing. Those girls were exhausting, but it's good that they have stories that get them on the right path. So good work out there. Powerful princesses. Well, it's Bay Ridge versus Sheepshead Bay when two members of the Catholic High School Athletic Association, Zverian High and St. Edmund's Prep, face off in a rivalry dating back two decades. We took our cameras to Aviator Sports Complex and the Abe Stark Arena and watched the action on the ice. Take a look.
Years ago, it was a little bit more intense because we're on rival schools, and it creates a very strong, intense rivalry, which is a lot of fun for the game.
I've never seen such a big crowd, and that's like what the hockey team is known for.
My teammates, they told me like it was a real physical game, you know, a lot of skill, pace was fast, and we were just going at each other, just trying to get that next goal.
There's no feeling each other out. We already know, like, from like the beginning of the game how they're going to play.
Besides playoffs and championships, this game is probably the biggest game of the year.
The two neighborhood schools were relatively close, I would say within 5-6 miles of each other. And the schools compete for a lot of the same kids. So a lot of the same kids are friends with each other. So there's a built-in rivalry right there.
Right, attaboy, Richie. Good job. Good fight, James.
Got a few friends on that team. It's a big competition against them. It's a passionate sport, hockey. Especially if our friends are on the other team, it's very competitive.
Set the tone early here. We're gonna pump some goals in that net. We gotta win these games. We gotta win two, boys. Let's go. Pump it up, baby. Starting off with the
X-3 on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Yerkin's line. Yerkin, Suma, Joe K.
Like I said, guys, I want you guys to roll straight through, but don't overdo it, okay? What I mean by that is you don't have to skate with the puck from one end all the way to the other through 5 skaters. Do your job, all right? Go down, win the corners, win every loose puck. We do that, we will handle this game. It's all about us, guys. Tonight and tomorrow night, it's in our hands, nobody else's hands, all right?
Here you go. 1, 2, 3,
all right, now we can line up here.
You're in good shape, buddy. Stay focused, that's all right. Don't worry if the puck goes in the net, it's no big deal. We'll get him back for you. Good luck, guys. Good luck, fellas.
All right, let's change it up, guys. Let's go. Z, picture perfect on the side over there. Picture perfect.
Wide open. Nice save.
Nice.
Body on him, let's go. Hey. They always have guys in front of the net. We gotta have guys in front of the net, fellas. Let's go. Go get it, go get it. Got
move
Joey.
Move it.
You got
it. Go, Tequila.
Watch your back.
Okay, he's a little short. You're right, but
I'm gonna scream him here.
All right, Joe. Good game, guys. Man, he was on his head there.
Yeah.
Playing great in net. Good game, guys. Awesome game in net, man. That was the difference in the game, I think. That was
big smart coaches, you know?
That was the difference in the game.
This is great. This is what high school hockey, the best thing about it, you don't get this anywhere else, you know?
Very emotional game. A lot of times you can jump out early and pop off one or two goals and then you try and hold on. That's kind of what happened tonight. We got a good lead, but we saw it. It never stops. They both go at it until the very end. It's a great rivalry.
These kids have been talking about this all week, and as you know, probably for a couple of weeks, they've been talking about it. And it means a lot to the schools. It means a lot to these kids, even the kids that don't play. It means a lot to them as well. Absolutely. Big rivalry.
There we go. Look at the seal on him.
St. Edmunds that won 2 straight games when they defeated Zavarin will move on to the playoffs. And unfortunately for Zavarin, well, there's always next year. All right, from high school to amateurs and now to paid professional hockey players, we're talking about the New York Riveters, one of the 4 teams in the National Women's Hockey League, the first professional league of its kind. They just got started this past October, and they played their home games at the Aviator Sportsplex. Joining me in the studio are 3 members of the Riveters. First, Janine Weber. She's also a forward, and you're from?
Austria.
Austria. Thanks for coming. Welcome. Thank you. And also joining me is Madison Packer. Madison, where are you from? Also a forward with the Riveters.
Detroit, Michigan.
All right. And also is Bray Ketchum. Bray, also a forward. Where are you from?
Greenwich, Connecticut.
All right, so you're not too far. You're in the metropolitan area, right? All right, good. First thing, we'll talk about your season. How's it been going so far? I know there's been a bit of a struggle. This is your inaugural season, so there's been some ups and downs, right?
Yeah,
Jump in.
It's been a bit of a rough year. I think that for most of us, we don't have any national team players, anything like that, aside from Janine, but we don't have any U.S. national team players. So for a lot of the girls, we had to come out of retirement and start training again, get back into the swing of teams things. So it took us a little bit longer to get back into shape, I think. But fortunately, everyone makes the playoffs, and you only have to win 4 games. So.
And it was also, I mean, a point of, I guess, creating some sort of chemistry. Was that also an issue, you think?
Yeah, I think a lot of us kind of knew each other, but we had never really played with each other. So I think we've been getting better as a team, you know, after a lot of practices. And I think we have a great team with players that would sacrifice a lot for a team. So I think that's what's going to help us out in the end.
How do you feel about that, as far especially with the playoffs? You got the playoffs next month. And is the chemistry there right now? Because I know there were some struggles in January, especially, right?
I think we're beginning to really come together as a team. I mean, we've had some really tough losses recently, but we've played really well. And I think, you know, we're building up to the playoffs. And I think we're at a good point right now. And we're feeling confident in one another. And hopefully the Isabel Cup will be ours. But, I think we're excited to, you know, it's sad that the season is almost over, but we're excited to get into playoffs.
What was it like in the beginning, knowing that you were going to be part of something innovative, revolutionary, especially in terms of getting paid to play?
I think it was pretty special. You know, a year ago, this wasn't even a thought on anyone's radar. It wasn't an opportunity that we had. So to be acknowledged and to have that kind of validity that we are athletes that are worthy of a paycheck and that people are willing to pay to watch us play and they're willing to buy our jerseys and buy season tickets and things like that. It was just a kind of a cool moment and like a feather in our cap kind of.
Yeah, I think just seeing all the young fans that come out to our games, I think it's this league has been a great addition to women's sports, and I think this is a huge time for women's professional sports. You know, the World Cup women just winning. And then the last Olympics, the U.S.-Canada game was the most viewed game in the Olympics. So I think it's an exciting time for us. And, you know, what better is that than to get paid?
I know it's early as far as this is your first inaugural season. This is your inaugural season. But in terms of a rivalry, do you have a rivalry with Buffalo, with the, you know, let's go. Have you developed one yet?
I think we were actually talking about this out there before. Yeah. I like playing Boston. Their answer, I think, is different than mine. I like playing Boston just because I played in college with a few of those players. I played in high school with a few of those players. And it's always a good grinding out, dirty game. So I like playing Boston.
Yeah, I think Boston is definitely a big game for all of us. Also, Connecticut has been, we've had some close games against them, a little bit of scrums here and there, so I think those games are always tough.
Go ahead.
Just because there's 4 teams, I think we play every team 6 times, so I think by the end we're pretty much, you know, we know everyone on that lineup, and it's been
now,
exciting.
Also, tell me about your background. How long you been playing?
I started skating when I was about 3. I have an older brother, a younger brother, and a younger sister. We all grew up playing together. I started playing because I wanted to be just like my older brother and do everything that he did, so I grew up, started playing with my siblings, and then I played all through middle school and high school in the metropolitan Detroit area. And then I graduated high school and went and played 4 years at the University of Wisconsin. I was in and out of the national program for a little while.
And you were going to walk away, right, from what I gather?
Yeah, I was done after my senior year of hockey in college. I had 1 more semester, and I had completely walked away from hockey for almost a year. I was doing training for a triathlon with my mom, and I kind of didn't, it was up in the air what I wanted to do. I didn't have anywhere to go. So it was either play beer league or pick up or be done.
How about yourself?
I grew up in Connecticut, and I played the same kind of thing. 2 of my older brothers played hockey, and I kind of was, you know, thrown to the rink every Saturday morning and watched them and fell in love with the sport. And then I played boys hockey up until high school, and then played on a girls' high school team and club team in Connecticut, and then
in Austria.
Yeah, I grew up playing with boys. There are not a lot of girls playing hockey in Austria. There's more now, but then I played on a girls' team through high school, and then I went to university in Austria and played on a girls' team there, and then I played 1 year at Providence College.
Now, this is a tough sport. I mean, there's no ifs and buts about it. And you do have your share of fighting, or if you want to call it scrums. Do you have a lot of those during the particular matches at all?
There have been a couple. I may have been the disturber on a few of them. But we get, I mean, there's no, people aren't ripping buckets off and punching people in the face. But we get in scrums. I mean, we have the same edge to compete, and we want to win just as bad as the men do. So we obviously aren't viewed as attractive if we walk around with a bunch of scars on our face, so we're all pretty conscious about getting hit in the face.
That's that sexism, huh? Got to keep pretty face, ladies, right? Yeah. Now, when you look at, as far as you got the playoffs coming up pretty soon, you have 2 more weeks left in the regular season?
Yeah, 3 more games.
3 more games, right? So how does it look for the playoffs? I mean, because the playoffs, as you know, is a whole new season.
Yeah, I mean, right now it's, you know, people are battling for first, second place, third, and fourth. So it's going to come down to the last 3 games where we place, and then we'll probably either play Boston or Connecticut in the first round.
And that's what he is about, Cup, right?
Yep.
How do you feel about the playoffs, your playoff chances?
I feel good. I think that we, like Bray and Janine kind of said, that we're a team that comes to the rink every day. We compete. We care about each other. Everyone's there because they want to be there. You know, we moved to an expensive city, not making very much money, so we've all made a lot of sacrifices throughout the year. And at the end of the day, everyone makes the playoffs, and you only have to win a couple games to win everything. So we've had a lot of close games. We haven't had a lot of bounces go our way. So eventually the luck's got to turn a little bit.
What's been the reaction also? Because I gather you've been outreaching to the community, to the various communities up in Harlem, hockey up in Harlem, parts of Brooklyn, parts of the Bronx. What sort of reaction are you receiving?
I think it's been pretty positive. I think, you know, as I said, the young kids are really involved in our league, and we've tried to we had a autism game, and we went and played street hockey with a few of the kids in Brooklyn, and we've worked at a women's shelter and served food to them. So we're trying to stay involved in the community, I think, and, you know, along with us providing, you know, service to them, they're also coming to our games and being really supportive, and the fans have been awesome.
Your next home game?
This Sunday at 2 p.m. against the Buffalo Buttes.
Right. And once this season is over, what will you take away from this season?
I think there's a lot of things. Mostly, we have had incredible fan support at our home rink and all the other rinks as well, but I think our fans have been really special coming back every weekend, even if, you know, games aren't going our way, but I think that's really special for us.
Yeah, and I think just, you know, taking a step back and really taking the whole experience in, it's been really incredible for a lot of us. And, you know, we hope that it only grows in the future, so.
So, what would you take away?
Yeah, mine's kind of similar to Bray. I think that we've realized that we're really a part of something that's so much greater than ourselves, and we've given little kids an opportunity to have a realistic dream. So being a part of that and watching it continue to grow, it's been pretty cool.
And all home games are held, for those who are interested out there, are held at the Aviator Sportsplex out in Flatbush Avenue. Mm-hmm. I wish you ladies tremendous luck, especially for the playoffs. Bring the Isabel home.
Thank you so much.
All right. Up next, the restaurants, bars, and venues in Brooklyn have all the buzz from our friends at Brooklyn Buzz. But first, from the B-side, here is Rhythm, Stealth with the World 1-1. We'll be right back.
All right, a little rhythm and stealth to get you going on a Wednesday afternoon from our live music show, B-Side, which is taking place tomorrow night right in this studio. So check out our website, brickartsmedia.org, for info on that show. But that's tomorrow night. We got a whole weekend ahead of us, and the weekend definitely feels like it's upon us. I may be getting a little ahead of myself, but it's already Friday in my mind. So we're in luck because we got a bunch of smart suggestions, probably enough for a couple of weekends at least, from the director of Buzzin' Brooklyn Buzz. The Buzzin' director is here himself, Mr. Stan Parham. Welcome back to BK Live.
Thanks for having me once again.
So for those who don't know, I don't know how many are left out there. Give us an overview of what Brooklyn Buzz does on the daily when you're not here.
Well, we're a society, cultural, we talk about any range from new restaurants to fashion to what's buzzing in Brooklyn, anything that's pertinent primarily.
All right, so you've got some suggestions for stuff that we could be doing this weekend. It's going to be cold. It's going to be a little romantical, maybe, if you're in for that Valentine's Day stuff. What's your first suggestion?
We have a list. We have a list of places and things to do far as live artists, R&B artists. We got some jazz events. To suit everybody's need, major indoor events. The Amarachi Prime over.
Yeah, that's what we're looking
over,
at now, right?
Over in
that's
Flatbush, over right at the mouth of the Manhattan Bridge, and on Wednesdays they offer like $5 power. A whole mixture of drinks. It's $5, and it starts at 5 p.m. And they're going to be doing specials throughout the month with appetizers as well as drinks.
But tonight's the night. Get in there five. Go have a little after-work drinky-poo.
Absolutely.
Sounds good. So how do you differentiate Brooklyn Buzz from the rest of the websites that are out there? What makes you guys have a little different take on things?
Well, I have a personal relationship with the proprietors and the owners there as well. And we just look for things that's buzzing with a good vibe, very wholesome. The food has to be great as well. Yeah. And because you want to go back as a repeat.
Right.
So, yeah.
A good drink doesn't hurt either.
Have those two, three components. Yeah.
$5. All right, so we're going from Amarachi Prime at the mouth of the tunnel down there to what's next?
We got the AP Cafe out here in the section, Bushwick section of Brooklyn.
Okay.
They offer fine coffees, teas. They have like savoring pastries as well as the atmosphere there is nice. They have a beautiful skylight.
Yes.
The seating there is close to about 2 years old.
So even on one of those cold, clear days, you can get all that nice sun filtering in when you're inside and it's freezing outside.
Soup and grilled cheese to warm up the soul.
Wow, that's a good combo. You can never go wrong with the grilled cheese and the soup. All right, moving on. BK9.
Yeah, BK9 is in the historic Park Slope section here in Brooklyn.
Okay.
Just opened September of 2015.
Huh.
Caribbean restaurant theme. This weekend, they're going to be offering live R&B this Friday. Showtimes is at 10:30. All of these things that I'm mentioning is on their sites as well as on Brooklyn Buzz as well. So that's a fairly new spot right here, right in the heart of Solar Park Slope.
Very cool. And what's really good about Brooklyn Buzz, too, is that you guys don't just have tunnel vision and you stay in one neighborhood. There's spots all over the borough that, and like you had a Caribbean sort of slant here.
Right.
There's the AP Cafe as well in Bushwick. So you can actually traverse the borough and sample different things in different sections.
Yeah, the ultimate goal is to saturate all of Brooklyn. We want to have everyone under our umbrella at some point in time.
Correct? All right, well, another place under that umbrella, Brooklyn Eats.
Yeah, Brooklyn Eats is another great place here in Fort Greene, Brooklyn. It's Brooklyn Eats Sports Bar. They offer, they have an extensive happy hour as well, primarily sports of any kind there.
Lemon Taki.
Yeah, you can probably go see that as well.
Yeah.
But particularly, it offers for the kind and we launched our second year anniversary there. So so the relationship we have there is because, you know, we go back and we continue to go back.
You recommend them. You're also a customer.
Right, right. And they love us there. So I mean that and it's a great spot. They've been there close to 2 years. So So those are the relationships.
There's a lot of mix of new and established places and people really getting a foothold and developing their language. Have you noticed any trends recently about the places that are coming on board and being successful, where sort of the energy is?
Well, they're including all of the neighborhoods, so they're neighboring. So you really want to step out of your neighborhood and go into other neighborhoods, which, you know, that offer those varieties. Yeah. So that's a great look as well.
All right. So Fusion. Oh, no. Brooklyn Moon.
Yeah. Brooklyn Moon.
So you said a mix of the new and the old. Yeah,
Well, those can rediscover
Brooklyn Moon.
Right. Brooklyn Moon. And, you know, we try to capitalize on anything that's Brooklyn, you know, related. And Brooklyn Moon in particular, this is their 21st year.
Wow.
Yeah. They're
finally legal.
Yeah, so, and the food there is very delicious. On Wednesdays, they have jazz. They have jazz at the 6 o'clock hour from 6 to 9.
Okay.
And they offer a nice happy hour from 5 to 8, and then Tuesdays through Friday from 3 to 8 happy hour.
Oh, yeah, it's down the street from the office here. We've been known to kick off early and stumble out of Brooklyn Moon when happy hour is over, very happy. But Fusion Eats, what's up with them?
Yeah, Fusion Eats is our next one. We featured them on about a year ago. Fusion, another Caribbean restaurant.
Caribbean soul food.
Yeah, Caribbean and soul food out in East New York on Elton Street out by the Gateway Mall.
Right.
Great food, great atmosphere.
It's a great room.
Also, this February 21st, they're going to be doing artists for Black History Month, and you can meet the artists. And today, this evening at the 6 o'clock hour, the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce is going to be doing a network mixer there this evening. So you may want to peek in on that.
Oh, that's good. Bring your resume. And a firm handshake. The Chamber of Commerce is out at Fusion East. And finally, we got Ray's.
Yeah, Ray's.
With the W-R-A-Y-S.
Right, correct. Another Caribbean restaurant here in Fort Greene, Brooklyn section of Brooklyn. The atmosphere, the layout is between two brick walls. Mm-hmm. They offer great drinks, happy hour. The proprietor there is very warm and friendly. So you need to poke your head in there as well.
Yeah.
Caribbean theme food daily.
Very cool.
Yes.
So best happy hour in Brooklyn.
Say that again?
The best happy hour in Brooklyn.
You can't go wrong.
Well, I'm asking you for yours. If you had to, all of your kids here are on the list. If you had to pick a happy hour in Brooklyn where we'd most likely find you on the bar stool, where would you be?
Yeah, I would be at Brooklyn Moon.
Okay.
Yeah, Brooklyn Moon, the food there, like I said, is very sensational. Mm-hmm. You can't go wrong. But, you know, you still want to, like, switch up every now and then.
21 years later, they got to be doing something right in
absolutely.
There for happy hour.
That's what have me there as
but
well.
But you've got a lot of great new places to try out on your list as well. So thanks for coming by.
Thanks for having me.
Let people know where they can get online with Brooklyn Buzz.
Yes, we're at www.brooklynbuzz.com. And just check it out. I mean, we're going to be doing a few great things for 2016. We're going to be doing working with the Soul Summit Music Festival here in Fort Greene, Brooklyn.
Top of the hill.
They're going to be, this is going to be their 15th year. As well as we're going to be working doing events with JIG Media, as well as we're going to be out at Coney Island where they play music on the boardwalk, different DJs. That's going to be 11 seasons, and they're going to feature this DJ, The Real, Curvin Mark. So that's going to be, like, very, very something to look forward to, and we're going to be on board with Fashion Week Brooklyn this year. They're going to be celebrating 10 years, so this May and September, We're going to be a part of that, as well as JIG Media. So it's going to be great. So we ask in all of our subscribers and, mm-hmm. and viewers just to check out the site.
All right. You heard it here first, folks. There's got a lot of stuff over at Brooklyn Buzz to keep you busy all year. Thanks for coming by again.
Thanks for having me
once
again.
We'll see you soon with more buzzworthy things.
Yes, we will.
Riveting. Well, tomorrow on BK Live, we're more or less devoting the show to three things. Valentine's Day, movies, and beverages. The Movie Date podcast team of Kristen Meinzer and Rafer Guzman are going to reunite to do some film therapy right here in our studio. Now, what that means is they're going to be prescribing specific movies for relationships problem that some people have sent to them. Then Adam Shartoff kicks off his Pulling Focus series, profiling profiling Brooklyn filmmakers. And he's starting with an interview with indie director Alex Ross Perry, and he drives him into Manhattan, and then on the red carpet, he got to chat with the stars of Alex's latest film, including a Ms. Elizabeth Moss. Mad Men fame. Nice. And then Dick and Dave will give us all sorts of unexpected tips for Valentine's Day in BK this weekend. And they'll be joined by Sarah Tracy of The Lush Life NY, who's going to talk about the right wines for romance. The Lush, anyone? We'll see you on BK Live tomorrow. Have a good day, everybody. Bye now. Stop.